I have again the difficult task this year again to talk about laboratory to a honorable crowd of people that deal with patients and not with laboratory tubes. And our beloved scientific chair gave me the task to talk about quality assurance, which is certainly an important topic. But I was wondering, how can I make this interesting for a crowd of clinicians? So I'm not going to be too technical, but I'm going to talk about what are the key considerations and way forward in the context of advancing quality assurance for HIV testing in the context of universal health coverage and Africa health security. So I hope that in 30 minutes you will have a better understanding of what quality assurance is within the larger aspects of quality management system, what is the link between quality assurance and achieving the goals of the 90-90-90, universal health coverage and global health security, and what are the challenges and the lessons that we learned in quality assurance, and we'll be using external quality assessment as a case, and finally, what are the policy implications when we want to advance quality assurance. So I think it's always very important to go back to basics when we have a talk like this and really get some definition straight. And I wanted also to come back to the importance of laboratory testing in the management of HIV infection. So we use laboratory testing for screening, risk stratification, diagnosis, treatment selection, and monitoring. And there are a lot of diagnostics and tests that are used, from HIV rapid tests, the screening of opportunistic infection, CD4 count, viral load, early infant diagnostic, and HIV drug resistance. So any laboratory error or malpractice for any of these different tests can really have negative impact and unrecognized HIV infection for those patients that are not being picked up by the screening test, unrecognized severity of infection, unnecessary, delayed, or inappropriate treatment. And that has, again, consequences on the continuous transmission of HIV, unfavorable clinical outcome, additional direct and indirect costs, because you need to have additional testing, you need to pay more for treatment that are not adequate, and a general mistrust in laboratory tests from the clinicians and from the patient. And that has a very negative impact on the achievement of the 90-90-90. So there are also important definitions. Many people talk about quality assurance and quality control in an interchangeable way. But they are both sets of activities, but they have different purposes. Quality assurance is used to ensure quality in the process of testing, while quality control is used to ensure the quality of the test results. So quality assurance is more like a prevention tool, and quality control is more like a corrective tool to check the test results. It is also important to understand what is quality management system. It's a formalized system that documents all the processes, the procedures, and the responsibility for achieving quality standards. And it addresses many different aspects of quality that can go to process controls, workforce, supply chain, customer services. So if we would try to show these different elements in a diagram, we would start with the most simple activity. These are quality control. You make sure that the test, the result of the test is correct. And for example, you incorporate internal quality control, positive and negative, in your test. And you make sure that your equipment is well maintained. And then you start to have it more complicated. You have quality assurance. You make sure that all the measures are in place to make sure that the quality is there. And for example, external quality assessment, we'll come back to it, is part of it. Then you have the quality system. It becomes more serious. You really make sure that the leadership, responsibilities, organizations are in place, everything is documented and tracked. And for example, for a lab, that would be making sure that you have a quality manual in place and that you have internal audit to check your processes in the laboratory. And this is really a cycle all the time for quality system and quality assurance. You test the quality of your process or your test, you identify the gaps, you improve, you start again. And finally, you have the quality management system, whereby you make sure that there's a continuous quality improvement of your lab towards accreditation. And Some of you that work with the lab, you understand that the SleepTap program, which provides a benchmark to assess the progress towards the ESO requirement, and the SleepTap program that teaches you how to do that, are very important. So now that the definitions are in place, let's see and let's look together that all the diagnostics should be quality assured everywhere and for everyone. So what is true for HIV is true for all diagnostics. And it allows the appropriate identification of diseases, appropriate treatment, effective disease surveillance linked to care. Because if you have a good diagnostic, then you have a solid surveillance. And this, ladies and gentlemen, is about achieving the goals of universal health coverage, effective prevention, and public health action for health security in Africa. So, of course, quality assurance is important, and you can see over the year, from 2011, when ASLM was born, to date, there are a lot of guidelines and manuals that have been developed and disseminated. And they can address the whole laboratory or specifically look at HIV testing, specific look at point of care, or specific look at early infant diagnostic, and then use new technology and internet to be disseminated. And many stakeholders that you see listed here have provided input to this guidance. So what does quality assurance? It really tries to identify what is it in your system when you are testing that does not work. Is that the specimen? Is it the tester? Is it your laboratory? Is that the supply chain? So that's what quality assurance is supposed to do, answer those questions. So within quality assurance, it was identified as a priority that external quality assurance are a minimum requirement when conducting HIV testing. So in our limited resources, that's really a minimum to make sure that you have your EQA in place. And this is why we are going to focus on that today. So what is it? EQA is a system to objectively check the laboratory performance using an external agency or facility. So it identifies areas for improvement and is part of accreditation system. And there are different methods to do EQA, and most of the people know the proficiency testing, but there are other ways to do that. You can also do a blind retesting of both positive and negative samples, and you can also do on-site evaluation. But because some of those methods are associated with cost, panel testing is the one that we do most of the time. And for HIV, then we have a lot of different proficiency testing scheme that have to address flow cytometry, molecular testing, and also serology. So a typical EQA program, how does it look? There has to be an organizing laboratory that prepares the samples for the proficiency testing and then distribute that panel to participating laboratories. And they are going to examine the samples, typically 5 samples, 2 to 6 times a year. They report the results. The organizing laboratory analyzes the results, collate all the different output, prepare the reports, and sends back to those laboratories that are assessed. And with that report, the laboratory should identify the gap and take corrective action. If there are no corrective action, there is no purpose to external quality assurance. So this is an example of how a result looks like. And I didn't find, for one reason, any results that relate to HIV that I could show you. So this is the result of stool analysis for parasitology, but all those EQA results are the same. So first you see the score of your own laboratory, and it tells you whether you pass or you fail for a specific testing. And then it compares, it shows the results of all the laboratories that participate, and then it shows how you stand, your own laboratory, how you stand in comparison to all the other laboratories, whether you are an outlier in a good way, you perform better, or whether you perform less than the others. And there are a lot of benefits in doing that. It provides early warning for systematic problems. It can serve as a quality indicator for stakeholders. Many people today showed results of clinical trial, and it's important that the laboratory that support those trials have a good quality and performs well in EQA. It monitors trends in result, and it could identify, for example, that the test kit over the time doesn't maintain the quality, and that can contribute to post-market surveillance for in vitro diagnostics. So there are key considerations when we implement EQA for HIV testing. Well, the implementing partners or the donor. So first of all, there's an increasing number of facilities to enroll in the program because in the change, the evolution of policy, the test and treat, the scale up of viral load, there is evolving technology that involve more automation. And the question is, does that induce less errors? There is a multiplicity of platform and assays. And there are also evolving public needs, and in certain, very recently, the recency assay is recommended to also provide data on the prevalence of HIV as we do the screening. And then the testing is moving closer to the community. So there are more point of care instruments. Many people that operate those instruments are not trained as laboratory professionals. And those instruments can be in very remote area, which has consequences when you have to transport the EQA panel to the facility. So what have we learned? And I try to show some lessons that we learned from PEPFAR, not because PEPFAR is the only partner that is helping, but because they have an incredible amount of data for a very long period of time. And here we have some experience from EQA of HIV rapid test in Haiti, and that's a publication that appeared last year. And Haiti is a small island where there is some significant prevalence of HIV and where the systems are challenged with all sorts of dysfunctions. So they have a screening algorithm for HIV diagnostic that is based on very robust rapid test in which all positive samples are retested. So you would think, okay, the rapid tests are validated, it should work. But however, a survey in 2012 showed that 72% of surveyed sites had discrepant results of HIV rapid test among pregnant women, which really shows that quality assurance is very important. So between 2006 and 2016, PT panel have been provided by PEPFAR, and this is the result of the participating lab over the year. And there are some good news that the enrollment of facility really increased from 70 labs in 2006 to 160, so that was very positive. And overall, they all had a good performance because they had a performance that was higher than 90%. But when we look at the result more closely, we realize that 53% of those PT testing were giving the PT testing to the most experienced laboratory technician. And for those HIV testing sites in the community, they were either not participating or sending the panel to the laboratory, which was really not the point. So we need to make sure that the PT panel are treated like any routine samples and not that when it comes, it's the best technician or the best laboratory that tests that panel. And there's also a need to find ways to also deliver EQA to the community. For early infant diagnostic, this is how a PT panel looks. So you have those DBS for the PT panel itself and also for positive and negative control. And there are instructions that come to the laboratory to explain what they have to do. So here, over 7 years, the quality performance increase over time, which is good news. So the more you participate in EQA, the more quality you have in your test. Something that was very interesting and that this figure shows is that the higher the number of early infant diagnostic facility in a country, the lower the score. So as we scale up EID, it is very difficult to maintain the quality of those facilities. That's what this figure shows. Additionally, 10% of laboratory could not achieve the 30-day turnaround time for the return of result, which really showed that there was a problem in the larger, the wider systems that underlie laboratory testing. So also for EQA and viral load, there were almost the same percentage of laboratory that it doesn't matter how the performance increase or how many more laboratory participate, there's always this 10%, 20% of laboratory that cannot return the results. And the main reason is that there's no reagent, expired kit, instruments that need repair, long delays in clearing custom. And sometimes the staff is reluctant to use the reagent for EQA instead of treating patients. So finally, I wanted to share with you an experience in delivering EQA in the context of a more comprehensive quality package, which is called the Stepwise Process for Improving Quality in HIV-related Point of Care. And this is a project that ASLM has been involved in a few years ago, and now within the Pan-African Consortium that we have with Africa CDC and ERSF, whereby our implementing partner, GHSS, implemented EQA through this package that also considered the integration of point-of-care services for patients, and you teach the facilities to test the right patient at the right time and to use support for patient care. It also tests the competency of testers, not only the testing sites, and also check from specimen collection to testing and to results. And finally, also monitor the quality, including EQA. And that's an example that shows a more effective building of quality system. But on the darker side, only 14 of the 50 facilities in the country that offer EID are supported through PEPFAR program, which means that the coverage is not enough. So in summary, what are the remaining gaps in quality assurance and EQA? So there's a big gap in coverage because QA and EQA should concern all laboratories and all HIV testing, and within the laboratories, all the testers that are involved in producing the diagnostic. The relevance of this EQA and QA, is it relevant to provide isolated components such as only EQA or only SLEPTA training or only SLAMTA training in the context where health systems supporting international health regulation and health security are needed? Is it sustainable? And I don't know if you had that same question, but really one of my worries is what will happen when international funding stops? And international funding will at least be reduced, and it certainly will happen, but we don't know when. So this really solving those questions goes beyond the laboratory. It also involves the ministries of health, regulatory agencies like WHO, stakeholders, Africa CDC, centers of excellence in Africa. What role can they play? And can we find a way to bring on board manufacturer and for-profit that also have a stake to make sure that quality is maintained in the laboratory so that they can continue to sell their reagent or their treatment and produce clinical and public health impact? So these are some recommendations to advance quality assurance for HIV testing from the vision of ASLM and from the different discussions that are going on the continent. So first of all, we think that we can increase the capacity to produce EQA. So this map of Africa shows you in green centers of excellence in Africa that collaborate with ASLM where EQA production is feasible. And here you see in those three highlights, you see the university, Cheikh Anta Diop in Senegal, NHLS in South Africa, and in Zimbabwe, they are already producing EQA for CD4, viral load, and EID. And this capacity can expand so that EQA program, the system is made as a regional PT program. These facilities, on the other hand, they could also help other EQA programs from WHO Afro, for example, for measles or meningitis, by serving as biobanks. So these figures show you the increasing contribution of local EQE providers on the PEPFAR funding. And you see over the years that Senegal and South Africa contribute more and more to the distribution of the PT panel. So this is possible, but what will happen when the PEPFAR funding stops? So we need to make sure that the country take this, or the region take this opportunity. The second recommendation is to support the uptake of innovation and solution to produce, deliver, or implement EQA. Technology, there are a few interesting things to do. Use dry blood, dry tubes that can be transported at room temperature, and they can be used to for molecular assays. Blood stabilizers and also EPT tool for the report of results, which reduces the turnaround time of results. The workforce, there are some interesting examples. A pilot has been done in Cameroon where some volunteer trained in the community to make sure that in every HIV testing site, they would help to implement the EQA and to make sure that the response were reported for analysis. And also the finance that is always almost forgotten. There are very few costing studies for EQA. And we can provide guidance to run EQA as a business. I think NHLS provides some leadership in that and provide opportunities for the manufacturers, insurance company to contribute to the cost of maintaining quality management system in Africa. So finally, something that is very important is to support the expansion of national policies incorporating quality requirements. So that's bringing QMS program at the next level and have country-owned program. And for example, we could franchise the SLIPTA or the SLAMTA program at regional or at country level. And some countries like Ethiopia, I think Kenya as well, already have this plan in their national laboratory strategic plan. And we can propose to use EQA requirement for the compulsory licensing of all public and private laboratories and revise the policy so that they include quality requirement as a regulation. That's the only way that we can set aside domestic funding for QMS and incentivize all laboratories to improve their quality. So I wanted to share with you comparative advantage of using the carrot or the stick or the fork to incentivize laboratories to be certified or accredited as a way to be licensed. So there are a few thoughts about the achievement of SLIPTA so far, and I didn't want to end that talk without talking about that, because ASLM spearheads that efforts on the continent. So we have made a lot of progress, but so far only 20 of the 52 countries of the WHO Afro regions are engaged in the SLIPTA, in the QMS. And when you look at the countries that are most advanced, Ethiopia, Nigeria, and Kenya, you see the little proportion of the laboratories that are actually implementing QMS as a regular, as an official system. And when you look at Niger, a Francophone country of West Africa, you see that they are not engaged at all. And this is very worrisome. When you look between 2016 and 2018, overall, is there an improvement of the distribution of SLIPTA stars, which means the progress that laboratory make? You see that there's very little. And why is that? It's because although the facilities, they do their best, the policy enablers are not in place. They don't have the resources. They cannot pay for a quality focal person. The supply chain is not in place, and they cannot move. So we really need to act at a higher level. So there is enterprising leadership for the SLIPTA implementation at regional level. It's not only WHO Afro, it's not only ASLM. You have this health organization from ECOWAS, you have WHO, you have the East Central and Southern African health community that are now taking leadership to move QMS as part of the regulation in their respective region. So I think altogether, this is really good news for QMS, for quality assurance, and for EQA. So thank you very much for your attention.